Having defined the singular chain complex and the singular homology of a topological space, let us examine today a few very, very important properties of this singular homology. These are going to be the guidelines for the entire homology theory later on. The properties of singular homology, some of them, not all of them, will pick it up as the fundamental properties and declare them as axioms. So the first one, very first one, is the functoriality. So first we have seen that from topological space to the chain complex level, it is a functor. Okay, S of XA DABA is a functor, it's a covariant functor from the category of topological pairs to the category of chain complexes. Then we have also seen that taking homology is a functor from the chain complex to the graded abelian groups, or graded modules. Thus, composing these two, what we get is the association XA going to H star of XA, as well as X going to H star of X, are functors, covariant functors. Okay. Given a map F from XA to YB, we shall denote F dot to be the map induced at the chain complex level, and S F star for the map induced by F dot on the homology level. Okay, quite often F star is used for both of them, and that makes it somewhat more confusing. So let us try to follow this convention. Okay, the star would be for the homology, and dot would be for chain complex. The functoriality is summed up in the following facts. Okay, I'm repeating it. We have seen it earlier. There is nothing new, but just to emphasize this one. If F from X to Y, G from Y to Z, G composite F star, the same thing as G star composite F star. If identity denotes the identity map of a space, X to X, then identity star from H star of X to H star of X is also the identity map on the homology groups. Okay, these are the two factors you have to understand. Okay, so this is one of the fundamental properties of the homology. It is not just some group out of nothing. Okay, it's functorial association. That's what one has to understand. The next important thing is the homotopy invariance of H star of XA. For any reasonable space, SN of X is a very huge group. Okay? Why we are taking such a huge group, we don't know. Because set of all maps from delta N to any reasonable space is going to be very huge. Of course, if the space is a discrete space or a single point and so on, then only we can know what it is and so on. Otherwise, it's quite heavy group. What is important is each SN of X is a topological invariant, but it is too huge. Okay, it's a topological invariant, but H star of X is defined as some subquotient. You take some subgroup and then the quotient of that group, right? This is strange that this quotient, subquotient group is going to be a homotopy invariance, which is stronger than being a homeomorphism invariant. So if it's homotopy invariant, then it will be homeomorphism invariant also. Because if x to y is a homeomorphism, then it has an inverse, actual inverse instead of homotopy inverse. So it is homotopy equivalence also. Okay. So the homotopy invariance we are going to state very clearly, namely if f and g from x a to y b are homotopic to each other, then f star equal to g star on h star of x a. Okay. So this is a statement, homotopy invariant. The maps induced by two homotopic maps, induced by them on the homology, they are actually the same. So we are not defining, we are not stating it in terms of the spaces, but in terms of the maps, which is a stronger result, okay? So that's where, that's what you have to pay attention to. From this, you will see that x a to y b, if f is from here to here, it's a homotopy in inverse, there g is inverse is there, then f composite is g composite is v will be homotopic to identity. Therefore, f star composite g star will be homotopy, is will be equal to identity, which means f star is inverse of g star. So that kind of things we would have got. So the homotopy invariance of the spaces will follow if you prove the homotopy invariance of the maps. So this is the statement. Okay. So we will go a little ahead in proving this one, but we will not complete the proof of this one. We will leave it at a stage wherein things become difficult. Okay. So let us see what is the easy part of the proof of this one. Start with a G, which is a homotopy from X A cross I to Y B, which just means that it's a map from X cross I to Y, such that A cross I goes inside B. That's all. The relative means that X A cross I is same thing as X cross I comma A cross I. So suppose this is a homotopy between F and G. Okay. Consider the inclusion map eta T from x a to x a cross I, which I have written here, I have written fully, is x a, x cross I, a cross I. What is eta t? Eta t of x is x comma t. So I am putting x in the x cross i at the tth level. Okay. So of these inclusion maps, eta naught and eta 1 are some important ones, specific ones. So G composite eta naught will be what? G of x0 is fx. G composite eta 1 is G of x1 is gx. Okay, where G is a homotopy. When you pass to the homology, this will imply G star composite eta naught star is G star composite eta 1 star. Suppose you have a map like this, okay. G composite eta naught is F, so take star of that. This is G star composite eta naught star, okay. And G star composite eta 1 is G. So you wanted them to be the same, so this will be G composite eta 1 star is G, okay. Passing on to homology, you get this. Therefore, it's enough to prove that eta naught star is equal to eta 1 star. This is what we want to prove. If eta naught star is equal to eta 1 star, then f star will be equal to g star. Okay, sorry, this is f star, this is g star. We want to prove that these two are equal. So for that, you don't have to worry about anything, but you have to just prove eta naught star equal to eta 1 star. So what are eta 1 and eta naught star? They are from h star of x a to h star of x a cross I. There are two maps. These two inclusion maps are there. They must be equal. So they are homotopic, of course. So the general homotopy has been cut down from arbitrary f and g for inclusion maps eta naught and eta 1, the coordinate inclusion maps. This is precisely what Poincare had done. So in the case of differential forms. So for this purpose, we construct a chain homotopy H from S of XA to S of X cross I, A cross I, between eta naught star and eta 1 star. Okay, at the chain level. So I should put here eta naught dot eta naught 1, I am myself not following. Eta naught dot and eta naught, eta 1 dot at the chain level. So if they are chain homotopic, then we know that chain homotopic maps induce same map at the homology level. So this chain homotopy is called the prism operator. Okay, it's from XA to X cross I, A cross I. Okay, so it's a prism operator. For future reference, we shall state this as a separate lemma so that we have to prove this lemma, not the whole theorem. Okay, what is the lemma? There exists a functorial chain homotopies. There is a whole lot of chain homotopies, H from. So you can write it as H of XA. So that is the way to write a functor. Okay, this itself is a functor, H of XA. It depends upon XA. H, SQ of XA to HQ plus 1 of XA cross I, Q greater than equal to 0, between the two inclusion maps, eta naught and eta 1. Okay, from XA to S dot of XA cross I. We shall postpone the proof of this lemma to the last section and take it for granted that the homotopy invariance is proved for the time being. Okay, but we'll now start using it. And first corollary is homotopy equivalent topological spaces have isomorphic homology groups, in particular contractible spaces, okay, have homology groups of a single point. Okay, so both of these we will keep using again and again. Contractible spaces, as far as homology is concerned, they are just like single point. Okay, well, do you know the homology of the single point? So that is what we have to do now. So luckily, we can do that. Okay, though we can't do much of computation here. So take n to be any positive integer. What are all maps from delta n to a single point space? The star bracket single denotes a single point space. Okay, what are all continuous functions here? What are all functions? It's only one function. Okay, and it's continuous. All right. Therefore, SN of this space is nothing but a group generated by one element, a free group generated by one element. So that is infinite cyclic. This is true for all n greater than or equal to 0. Delta naught is also a single point. Okay. For negative things, of course, we have defined them to be 0. Observe that. Now comes the crucial thing. From S2 n plus 1 star to S2 n, look at the boundary operator. This map from 2n plus 1 to 2n, I want to say it's zero map. Why? Because look at S2n plus 1. Let us say delta 1, n equal to 0, so S1. So then you have a one simplex here, which is a function from delta 1 to star. What is the boundary? The boundary operator will take sigma of 1 minus sigma of 0. Both sigma 1 and sigma 0 are just this point, singleton function. So the singleton function minus singleton function is 0. okay, in the free group. So if you look at now delta 2, okay, if you take so delta 1 I have done, so then next thing I have to take delta 3. Delta 3 is a tetrahedron. How many faces it has? 4 faces. So how does the function, the boundary operator look like? So alternative sum of constant function all the time. How many of them will be there? 4 of them will be there. So they cancel out each other and give you 0. More generally, from delta 2n plus 1, there will be 2n plus 2 of them terms, okay, each occurring with plus or minus 1 alternatively. So they cancel out each other. That is why from odd degree term to even degree term, this map is 0. For the same reason, from an even degree term to the odd degree term, there will be odd number of faces alternatively occurring. Only one of them will be left out. Which sign, it doesn't matter. It will be a generator, plus or minus. Right? So what we have is this sequence here. This is S naught. This is S1. So this map is, sorry, this is, yeah, what we have, what here? This map is 0. This is S1 to S0. This map is an isomorphism because it goes to the generator. Again, this map is 0. This map is an isomorphism. Alternatively, 0 and isomorphism are there. Now, when you take the kernel of this, okay, here you have to take the kernel of this, which is the whole thing. Image is 0. So H naught will be infinite cyclic. Here the kernel is the whole thing. The image is also the whole thing. The quotient will be 0. Here the kernel is 0. Image is also 0. Quotient is 0. Here the kernel is whole thing. Image is also whole thing. Again, quotient is 0. So everywhere the quotient will be 0 except the first one, namely the zeroth one. The zeroth one, the kernel is the whole thing, the image is 0. So this is infinite cyclic group. So what we get is H naught of star is infinite cyclic. Hi of star is 0 for all I greater than 0. Of course, for negative things, it is automatically 0. We don't have to mention that at all. So only the zeroth homology of a single point survives and the rest of the homologies are all trivial, all 0. All right, so let's go ahead. Homology long exact sequence of the pair. Just for this one, we made a lot of preparation, namely the snake lemma. Okay, so we'll use that one and see how we get this here. Already we have done that. So, by definition, S of XA is the quotient of S of X by SA. So, therefore, we have a chain complex here. Sorry, a short exact sequence of chain complexes here. S dot A to S dot X, this is the inclusion induced homomorphism, which is again inclusion homomorphism itself. So SX to S dot of XA, this is the quotient map, quotient homomorphism. Okay, so this is a short exact sequence of chain complexes. The snake lemma and then the theorem following that, we have deduced a long exact sequence of the homologies. What are they? This is the homology of this one is just HN of A, HN of X, HN of XA, and then delta going to HN minus 1, Hn minus 1, Hn minus 1. So I have written Hi, 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 Hi minus 1. The last four terms you can write down H1 of Xa, then H0 of X, H0 of A, H0 of X, H0 of Xa. After that, this everything will be 0. Okay. Out of this, okay, for singleton point, we know H0 of X. We don't know even these groups completely. So better to start computing these things. There is a long exact sequence which is functorial. This sequence comes handy in many computations, as we will see. Okay, when you have information here and information here, this group will be trapped between them. So you can get a lot of information on this one, if not completely. Okay, suppose these two are both zero, then this will be of course zero. So such things we will have to keep using. So these four properties are so fundamental. Okay, they have been raised to the status of axioms. There are some more of them, which we will take care of a little later. But now we will come to some other properties of the singular chain complex, which are special to the singular chain complex itself, singular homology itself. Okay, this may not be true for other homology groups. Okay, some of them may be true, but it may not be true. This is not part of the axiomatic kind of thing. So this is an extra property of homology. So homology of path components. So I have put it as an example rather than properties 1, 2, 3, 4. So you will have some more properties later on. Suppose you have a space X which has path components Xj indexed by J. Clearly, X is disjoint union of Xj's. Okay, since delta n is path connected, if you take any simple X, singular simple X, namely a continuous function from mod delta n to X, it will be inside one of the Xj's. Okay, therefore, the set of all singular simplexes of X is just the union of set of all singular simplices of Xj, the union taken over J. The set itself is partitioned like this. Therefore, the free group over that, free abelian group over that, will be the direct sum of the free abelian group over each of the Xj's. So Sx is a direct sum of Xj's. S of Xj's. The very first thing for homology of a chain complex that we have proved, namely, if you have a direct sum of chain complexes, then the homology is also the direct sum of the corresponding chain complexes. Okay, therefore, the homology of X is a direct sum of homology of each of its path components, Xj's. Okay? So here we have used the construction of the singular homology, not just some functorial properties and so on. Okay, it comes out of continuous functions from delta n, and therefore this is true. All right? Now we will do some more things. These things are concerned in the general construction also, but this is more motivated by combinatorial aspects. The reduced homology and H naught of a path connected space. Now why suddenly I have gone to path connected space? Because to compute the homology of any space X by this discussion, you have to do the homology computations of each path component. Once you know how to do for a path connected space, then you would know it for general things also. Therefore, you can concentrate on computations of path connected spaces. Okay, homology of computer path. So this we would want to do at least for H naught. Okay. So let us compute H naught of X for any path connected space X. Okay. The first thing is H naught is what? S naught, then you have to take the function, next function is zero there. And the previous function is S1 to X, which is Dawa. Therefore, H naught is nothing but S naught of X divided by the boundary, namely Dawa of S1. What is S naught? By the very definition, you have to take functions from delta naught to X. Delta naught is just a single point. Functions from a single point to X is just singletons, namely constant functions. Therefore, how many of them are there? Precisely as many as number of points in X. So S naught of X is a free abelian group over the underlying set X itself. For any one simple X sigma in X, the boundary of sigma is nothing but sigma of E1 minus sigma of E0. E1 and E0 are the respective edges, the vertices of sigma 1. Remember that, of delta 1. Okay? So this is the phase operator. So we define an augmentation map. This is called epsilon, is called augmentation map. This itself will be, that's what I was telling you. This itself will generalize. But here, we are defining this motivated by computation for this one. Okay. So what we are going to do, epsilon is defined for S naught of X to Z by this formula. Epsilon of Ni Xi is equal to summation of Ni. See, this is a free abelian group over X. Z is just the infinite cyclic group. So just add all the coefficients and that is the function epsilon. Okay. Which is the same thing as saying that all the points here are sent to one here. All the points are sent to the generator one here. Automatically summation ni xi will go to summation ni. So then epsilon is surjective homomorphism because X is non-empty. I have to start with a non-empty space. Okay. Then epsilon composite Dawa 1 of sigma is 0 because there is one vertex here, another vertex here, two points are there but with negative sign. So this is plus 1, this is minus 1, so sum total is 0. So epsilon of Dawa 1 of sigma is 0 for all one simplexes. Therefore, epsilon composite Dawa itself is 0 because these sigmas are the generators. So they are the basic elements. Okay. So what we have got is a surjective map with epsilon composite Dawa equal to 0. So this will be taken as a definition later on for augmentations. Right now, what we have done is this epsilon naught. How does this help to compute the homology? We will see. Okay. Finally, what we want to show is that kernel of epsilon, see here, kernel of epsilon contains the image of Dawa 1. But I want to show that kernel of epsilon is contained in the image of Dawa 1. Okay. So for this, consider an element summation ni xi, which is in the kernel of epsilon. Kernel of epsilon means summation ni xi, summation ni is 0. Like this element here, sigma 1. Sigma E1 minus sigma E0. The sum total of the coefficients must be 0. Take such an element. Take any point Z0 in X. Okay. X is path connected. Therefore, you can join Z0 to all these Xi's. Okay. By a path. What do you do? Declare a path from Z0 to Xi and call it as sigma I. Okay? And that sigma I being a continuous function from the closed interval can be thought of as a one singular simplex. Okay. Now you look at Ni sigma I. Boundary 1, dava 1 of this one is nothing but Ni sigma I of 1, which is starting sigma I of 0 or sigma I, doesn't matter which way. So starting with where we have taken sigma Ni of 1 will be Xi, sigma I of 0 will be Z naught for all of them. So it is summation Ni Z naught, here summation Ni Xi. Okay, so but this summation is 0, so therefore this is summation Ni Xi. So for each such thing, we have got a one chain such that its boundary is this one, which means the kernel of epsilon is contained in the dava 1, image of dava 1. Therefore, boundary operator S1 of X is precisely equal to kernel of epsilon. Okay, so hence we get what first isomorphism theorem is what? H0 of X, which is S0 of X, divided by the boundary of S1 of X, is S0 of X divided by the kernel, okay, that is isomorphic to Z. Because we have a map from S0 of X to Z, okay, which is surjective. So S0 of X modulo the kernel is isomorphic to Z. And this kernel is equal to the boundary is what we have verified. So this is by definition, this is H0. Thus, we have computed that H0 of X is isomorphic to Z. Okay. Whenever X is path connected. Just connectivity is not enough, by the way. You can give easy counterexamples. Okay, the homomorphism S0 of X to Z is called augmentation. Okay, using this, we extend the chain complex by altering it at the negative minus one level. That's all. Okay, Sn of X is Sn hat of X is twiddle of X is Sn of X. If n is greater than equal to 0, no change. It is Z with n equal to minus 1. 0 again if n is less than minus 1. No change. Accordingly, the DABA operator is same thing as DABA in n greater than equal to 1. From S0 to S0 twiddle to S minus 1, you take this epsilon. So this is the function S0 to this Z is becomes S minus 1 now, right? That's why this epsilon. Everywhere else is 0. So only this part, this was 0, and then further zeros. Instead of 0, we have put a Z, and this map was 0. Instead of that one, we have put epsilon. So that is called the extended chain complex or the augmented chain complex from S dot. Okay, so the idea is, if you look at the chain, if you look at the homology of this one, okay, that will differ only in H0 level. Okay, everywhere else it is the same thing. So that is also of importance, H0 twiddle of X, it's called reduced homology groups. Clearly, Hi twiddle is 0 for I less than 0, Hi twiddle is same thing as Hi for I bigger than 1 because the homologies and maps haven't changed. But in dimension 0, H0 twiddle of X, direct sum with Z will be H0 of X. So the homology of this reduced thing is reduced by one factor, Z. So it's called reduced homology. In particular, for a path connected space, H0 twiddle of X will be also 0. Without a twiddle, namely unreduced, it is Z. That is what we have proved. But that z factor goes away here. So h naught tilde of x will be 0. Okay, so one factor down, one z factor down there for h naught tilde. That's all you have to remember. Okay, now I will tell you something about why this kind of thing is there. For a contractible space, we have just seen that the homology is the same thing as homology of a point. For a point space, we have seen that h naught of z, h naught of star is infinite cyclic group z, and everywhere else it is 0. If you take the reduced homology, what happens now? The entire homology will be 0. Even at h naught, it will be 0. And this is what psychologically what mathematics wanted out of a contractible space. All the homologies are 0, they wanted to say. But that was not the case with the usual homology that we have defined. That h naught will be always surviving there as infinite cyclic. So you make a slight modification like this, somewhat unfunctorial. Okay, later on we can make it a functorial also in some cases. Okay, to make it so that the homology of a contractible space completely vanishes. Okay, so this was perhaps the motivation for making this augmentation and reduced homology. Okay, so note that for any non-empty subspace A of X, if A is non-empty, then S twiddle of XA, remember S twiddle of XA is by definition what? It is given by an exact sequence. S twiddle of A, S twiddle of X to S twiddle of XA, right? So both of them have increased in minus one, only in minus one dimension. There is a Z factor, they cancel out. So what you are left with, minus one factor of S twiddle of XA, is nothing, the same thing as S star of X. There is no change at all. Okay, therefore, the reduced homology for a relative pair when A is non-empty is the same thing as homology for the ordinary thing without reduced. There is no change at all. Okay. Now, what you can do is you can go back to the long homology exact sequence here. You can put a twiddle everywhere here. No problem. But when you come here, you have to be careful. H naught of A, okay, this is different from H naught twiddle of A to H naught twiddle of X. This is different, but this is the same thing. Okay, H naught of X. So does that fit here or not? You have to verify. If you have H naught twiddle of A to H naught twiddle of X, both the Z would have cancelled out here itself. And so this remains as it is. So this should still be an exact sequence. The exactness for H naught twiddle, twiddle, twiddle is not a consequence of this, snake lemma and so on. So you have to separately see that one. For only for this part, rest of the part is obvious because there is no problem. Okay, that is easy to see. So we can, because now we know what is H naught of A to H naught of A. Both of them are what? If A, suppose A is, A and X are path connected, both of them are Z, and this is an isomorphism. So like that, you can compute this one, even when A and X are not path connected, any arbitrary path component and so on. So this can be done. So it is not difficult. So you can verify that this part is exact. The rest of them are all as usual. Yeah. So that brings us to another very important property which is much more topological than whatever you have discussed. Out of these, we have discussed the one which is very topological was homotopy invariance, and the other one was, this one was also somewhat topological, path connectivity. Okay, so next one is much more topological, and that is called excision. We will study it separately next time. Thank you.